seconds. So for the rest of the talk, I'm Jerry, and I'd like this to actually be a discussion more than a talk. I know I've come here looking very official and all that stuff, but that's all I've got. Okay, and we have an hour and a half, so we need to fill it up, and I'm hoping for some help from you guys as well. So let me start with a couple of questions. What do you... Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, turn up your bit, all that stuff. So, how many of you have had any experience with a reptile? Okay. How many of you have had a positive experience with a reptile? Can anyone tell me? Can you waste about a minute and a half, please? What experience with a reptile? Yes, ma'am. Oh, okay. My uncle actually. So you've been introduced to reptiles. What about a reptile in your house or under your bed or your backpack in college? No one's ever done that to you yet? So what's the general fear? I mean, the general feeling when there's a reptile around? What is it? Pardon? Very creepy, all right?
Happy.
All right.
Fascination.
Okay. Who said fascination? Okay. Anything else? What do you think when you see or hear of, well, there's a reptile in the general vicinity? What do you think most of the country? So I'm assuming that I'm already preaching to the choir here. You guys are already converted, so it's going to be quite a pleasant talk. Don't change any of those. But. Generally in India or anywhere in the world, it's not the same. And the reason, one of the reasons why folks who do handle snakes, for example, are thought to be very cool or have some special skill, or as I've been told, have Garuda right here in their hand. So Garuda was, I had a day off and actually did get bitten by a snake,
but
so
I do this
he wasn't watching over me.
So
it's because of people's fear. Now, people are terrified of snakes, yes. They're terrified of geckos. They're terrified of a gecko this big. And some people are more terrified of a gecko this big than a crocodile that's 19 feet long. And they have no problem sitting in a boat right next to a crocodile that's, you know, just there and saying, that's not really right. But a gecko, which by any stretch of imagination, cannot do anything to you. Right? People say, oh, you know, one gecko killed 80 people at a wedding festival or a wedding function because it fell into the milk. But that's basically a gator who's used some really lousy material that's been lying out rancid in the sun for a week and then blames a gecko. You can eat a gecko. And then, trust me, they don't taste very good. But I once, when I was very young, ate a gecko to prove this very point. Can't do anything to it. Didn't cook it. I should have cooked it, but so what I'm trying to get at is conservation without, you know, uphill battles. The title of this talk is Uphill Battles, Uphill Struggles, Reptile Conservation. And I think it's true for just about any kind of conservation. Is misconception. We're not telling the truth about it. Someone who once comes to your house to rescue a snake, right, is this cool person who, you know, has a special skill. But the truth is, anyone who can ride a bicycle can handle a snake. It's not a big deal. It's nothing. It's a set of protocols. And the other truth is that snakes don't want to bite us, which is why we can't handle them. If they wanted to bite us, if we were food for them, we don't stand a chance. These animals are much faster than any human animal. So we're not the cool ones, we're just making use of a reality. That a snake has venom, yes. That venom is there for it to actually subdue and control its prey. Yes, sir. And it takes a lot of energy for that snake to make that venom. Hence. There's a message in that I hope. And So, okay, just see. So when the snake has the when the snake needs venom for prey, takes a lot of energy to produce that venom, and hence it doesn't want to spend it on some silly human to try to grab it by the tail. That is why we can grab a snake by the tail, not because we are super skilled, not because we can do anything different. It's because that snake doesn't want to bite us. The times we get bitten is when that snake wants to bite us. So it's not us at all. These are misconceptions. One of the major reasons I left television was most networks, or actually any network, refuses to say things like that. It refuses to say that, you know, these snakes are actually perfectly safe to be mixed. It's okay to have a snake bite, and you don't need to be able to handle snakes to be safe inside a box filled with snakes, because they don't want to bite us. So the networks don't want to do that. The audiences don't want to see that. They don't want to see someone saying, oh, here's this cobra. Can you pick it up and put it in a bag? No, they want, crikey mate, this is the most dangerous snake in the world. Right? That's what they want. So, in the introduction, there was this thing about, you know, greatly thanks to the media, or in a large part thanks to the media, reptiles are getting more popular. Popular is the problem. And how many, can anyone tell me why that's the same? Why is popularity? See, am I? Okay. No? All right. Yes. Okay, in my experience, more technology means, well, entertainment at least. We have an hour and a half. Hello? So, is it working?
Somehow makes them appear as the other or something exotic, or something unusual.
Okay, alright, yes.
It makes them prone to a chance of human interaction. People want to go and be like, see the tiger and shove it to the man. Like, for example, you shove a tiger and flash and after that, you go and face
him. Okay. I'm going to take some notes as well, okay, because I mean, this is one of the few times that I've actually been in a college, even when I should have been in college, so I'll take some notes. We'll get back to this thing as well. Yes, I saw.
Information that's not particularly right.
Yes.
I think what popular is doing is that it's giving us the opportunity to invade
So let's just talk about territories, okay? What's our territory and what's the animal's territory? Can anyone define this? So the leopard that near Urimli came into an apartment and took Lassie away, right? Was that leopard in his territory or not? But what is the general question? What is the general question? People ask, why is that leopard coming out of Burebili and into our place? When I get to it. I'm going to ask you to hold that thought for a second, because how do we have territories? What is that construct? Where did it come from? We talk about nature and conservation and the planet because this, we want to save this planet, right? This rock is rolling around, revolving around the sun every day. We're going to protect this rock, we're going to save it, right? What is this construct of territories? So it's always us and them, isn't it? It's always us and them. It's not just I'm here, it's here, he's here, she's here, they're here. It's all just is. We're unable to just allow anymore. We're unable to just share. So I've grown up on a farm. Okay, I grew up on a farm, and when I was growing up, and it's still just outside Bangalore city limits, 107 meters outside Bangalore city limits. Although, I mean, people are selling land everywhere, and there's apartments coming up. And we've got this little 2-acre oasis there. When I was growing up, and I'm not going to tell you when that was because that would give out too much information. When I was growing up, there was slender loris. I could find a slender loris in a half hour in the fence of my farm. I would go out and find snakes at will. There was almost no day that we didn't see a snake. There were monitor lizards, chameleons, all kinds of birds, and there were so many reasons not to go to school. It was right there. It was a wonderful place. People say, what a gorgeous place it is. It's not. To me, that was the gorgeous place when I was growing up. And these snapshots that people see now, they say, okay, fine. But now, Bangalore city limits are here. So now, the way I see it is my water table has gone down 500 feet. Right? We never had to recharge water because that happened naturally. There was a lake that was perennial where I would see painted storks, pelicans, yasanas, all kinds of stuff. I fantasize about crocodiles, but that never happened. But all that's gone. Why is it gone? Because we can own land. That construct of territories comes from the fact that we can own land. We can either own, and we can own anything that's not a person. And if you think about all the insidious ways in which our system works, we also own people. But we own these things. The state owns every single tiger. And because the state owns it, we actually own it by our construct of democracy. Is it a natural one? No, it's not. It's one that we hope works as well as it possibly can. But with each one of these constructs, we can use it to our heart's content, and if someone's really smart and as greedy as they want. But the fact is, animals aren't coming into our territory. We're not going to theirs. It's what is. It's just space. We actually can't own it because they never signed the sale deal, right? We bought this land, I bought this house, yeah, great place, fantastic, I'm going to build this little bungalow here. Okay, this is Bombay, I shouldn't say bungalow, no, that wouldn't make you feel bad. But it's, the animals that were there already, they never signed it. This is our construct. So it's like, it would be like you coming into my house and keep this. And now I'll sell it to you. Why? How can you do that? Because I drew this string around this thing first. This is mine. We haven't earned anything. It has been given to us by any greater power. It sure as heck hasn't been given to us by the planet. So let's remove this entire thing from the equation. For our territory, their territory. And if we can in the rest, so that's another hour and 10 minutes. If we can remove the us and them from this conversation, we might actually be able to think of what we could do to make things better, as fluffy as that sounds. So let's move from, can we do that? No us and them. We're all one big happy family. point at the pinkies. Can we do that? You guys are not answering me at all. So, so just, and also for the record, I don't ask rhetorical questions. If I ask you a question, I want an answer, okay? So, no ascendant. Name some other problems. And I think the conservation issues that are at hand are pretty much constant for all the animals that we have. There are a few specific ones to reptiles, but let's deal with the big ones, yes. Saving things. How many of you would like to save snakes, save tigers, save trees, save the planet? Let's hear a show of hands. Pardon? All of you who are present want to save them. Why? Why save snakes? Yes.
Because there are not just snakes, but there are others amongst us who are destroying them. So like to reverse the damage of the.
Okay. Any other reason? But so what if they die?
I think the world is balanced, and so like you know how they say it's the food chain, and people consider humans as the top of the food chain, but actually it's a web, and one small thing can amount to a very large consequence. Like one butterfly
effect. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Any other reasons why we should save them?
Anyone else that goes missing or that goes extinct will have a ripple effect.
Okay. right? Slap on some color as well. Okay. You really got me there. Okay. So I think what I was hoping for, and I like you to think about this. You're gone.
So it's a humane thing to do.
A humane thing to do.
Yeah, because it's another being, it's a life being that if you don't save it, no one else will. I mean, it's only humans are the power to save any other animal from going extinct. So it's not on us, it's no one else.
Okay.
I agree with her, and there are beauty of nature.
Okay.
I think we have a selfish reason. It's all in the middle, right?
You guys do really well in your exams, right? I'll tell you why I'm saying that. It's because all these are words, right? And I'd like you to think about one thing. Okay? The humane thing, nature is not humane. And if you want to save the planet, right? Name one thing that is based on sentiment or sensitivity. Name one thing that is natural. So our humaneness, our sensitivities, often can be equated to our weaknesses. This is where we do not want to step forward and say, you know what, we'll stick out in that storm of chaos that nature brings to us, and we will survive. And the ones that survive are the ones that should. That's nature. What do we say? We say, no, we shouldn't die. We must alleviate suffering. We can't have disease. We can't do all these things. We're actually quite gutless as a species. We're really gutless. So, if you look at, how many of you have seen a dog die, one of your dogs? Yeah. What did you see in that dog's face? Has anyone ever sat with your dog and watched it die? And that dog is not struggling anymore. Most often, if it's a natural death, that dog is just dying. It's amazing to watch an animal die. It's very, very few humans that have. They're devoid of sensitivities. They're devoid of these fears. They're not like us. All these constructs that we put together, that we have, you know, oh my God, this is terrible. They don't have that. They've done their bit. And they've done their bit. They've had this tiger. I've seen this footage of this male tiger dying. Most peaceful thing ever. Why is that possible? Because he has completed his job. Done. Over. Now I move on. So when we say we're part of a bigger thing, how much more of an understanding of being part of a bigger thing can you have than that? Yes, it's amazing. We're part of a bigger thing. The only bigger thing that we are part of is this massive, branded machine called civilization. It's a machine. Yes. Well, I'm saying we should be. I'm saying that we do everything in our power to be outside of it. Well, if we are foolish enough to think, let me know. Okay, what do you guys think first? And then I'll give you the answer. What do you think? Are we or are we not part of nature? Not part of nature? We're part of this one mass of energy, right? Carbon. And at the end of the day, some of us will die, go back to where we came from, all that stuff. We're part of it. We might think that we can beat it, we might think we're outside of it, we might think that we're really bad to it, but we're part of it. We cannot not be part of planet Earth. So even if we go away, the butterfly effect will still happen. We go to some other planet, we left some space. We have effect. We can only not be part of something if we don't have any effect. But we do. And then we figure out, okay, now this is our responsibility. And humans are the only ones with the power to save the planet Earth. So we should. Right? For me, I find that really presumptuous and pompous. I think we come from a really, really superior place where we say, we need to save these animals. And then what does it become? It becomes a cause. Right? So is conservation a good cause? You tell me. Is it a good cause or is it a bad cause?
It's a good cause.
It's a good cause, one that we're willing to fight for, right? Crap. Okay? A cause is like saving someone else and doing something altruistic. Okay? Going to the doctor is not a cause, right? When you get sick and something wrong, you break an arm or something, you need to get it fixed, that's not a cause. Conservation, if you don't save these things, I use the word save very, very glibly, is something that we need to do for ourselves. We're on the verge of absolute destruction, implosion actually, on every level, social, economic, cultural, ecological, environmental, we're on the verge of implosion, and that's been done by us, single-handedly. So yes, we are the most powerful people around, the most powerful things, and yes, we have the biggest effect on
it. But won't this conversation estimate to the extent of how long poaching and, you know, hunting is going to be around? Conservation,
because
we are the ones who are destroying the wildlife. If that wasn't happening, we don't need to be
the
ones saying that we have to
conserve
them,
we have to
save them.
We need to save them because we're the ones destroying them. Exactly. Thank you so much for saying that. Okay. When did you kill a last tiger?
Never.
You've never killed a tiger? No one here has ever killed a tiger? Not directly. Aha. So what do we hide behind then? We hide behind this guise, right, of legality. I haven't done anything illegal. And hence, I've never killed a tiger. I've never held a gun, looked a tiger as it sat down there over a prey and blown its head out. Well, actually, you can't blow its head out because then the value of the skin goes down. So you use small bits, right? So, but we've never done it directly. We've never done it directly, so we're not responsible for this. We've got 1,000, what, the last year was, no, 2011. We have 1,411 tigers left. Oh my God, what are we going to do? Where do you put any more than that? There's no place for them. Are we okay with tigers outside our backyard? No. We're not okay with that. We're not okay with the checkered keelback water snake outside in our backyard. Right? But here is where hypocrisy lies. We say that people who are living next to a tiger reserve or inside a tiger reserve, right, they don't have these rights. If a tiger kills one of them, or a snake kills one of them, they can't move that tiger's name because that's where they belong. So this is the first point of your policy, where we say, you know what, you don't have rights there. Even though you are the peoples who have not destroyed all the planet's tigers, you're the ones who've lived with them all this time. You're the ones who have saved your forest and worked in a functional way, and you take what you need. Yes, it's perfectly fine. We now go to them and tell them, you know what, these tigers belong to the state. This place belongs to the state. Let's get you out of there. These people who have not destroyed their tigers, we who have destroyed all our tigers, killed them all and everything, and continue to put pressures on those places that have the tigers left, are the ones who tell those people that they do not know what to do with our tigers. How is this possible? You know, the biggest problem with conservation today is no one calls a spade. All jargon. It's so easy to propaganda. Gimmicks, media. That's what the truth is. It's so easy to make it big in conservation today without doing anything. In fact, if you're making it big in conservation, and I'm going to go out on a limb here, you're most probably doing a lot of damage. So, what is the solution then to all this? Can we affect? What do we do? No ideas? Sure. Okay, does anyone have an idea that they're not sure they should say? Yes?
Reduce human population.
Pardon?
Reduce the population of human beings.
You know, that's actually really interesting. There's this study that was done. And these guys actually cap what the holding capacity of the planet is as far as humans go. And basically they cap it at 1 billion. Okay, 2 billion, yeah, we're at 7. Okay. But an interesting little Chavi master at one of these conferences stood up and he said, but sir, do you mean 2 million Jarawas or 2 million Texans? And that's the difference. 2 billion Jarawas, no big deal. I mean, they're there, they have their spaces, they don't all congregate to crazy extents. Yeah? they actually say, okay, fine, you know, the reason we'll stay here is because these many resources can support these many of us. They don't say, okay, fine, we'll go where we want to, and then we'll bring our resources to us. And we'll milk this place dry. They don't do that. Texans, yeah. So it's not about reducing the number. It's about us changing as individuals. And I know everyone says, how many of you have heard this more than you want, you ever wanted to? Every person can do it. You heard it, right? Yeah. So why don't we then? Why don't we? We highlight and we herald all these guys who have made these differences. The Mahatma Gandhis, the Jane Goodalls, all these people, every now and then, say, wow, look at what they did. So why don't you, hey, no, I can't hear. How are you going to do this? One person. What difference will it be? How do you adhere to every single thing? Lane discipline, for example. If we adhere to something as simple as that, staying in one lane. And it's also, I mean, forget about whether it's part of a system. That's actually common sense. You know, it really is. Everyone can actually get there faster if you stay in one lane. Brings me to the next thing that we need to make this video about. How many of you play a team sport? Yeah? Okay, so anyone tell me what the essence of that sport is? Tell me what sport it is and what is the essence of that sport?
Everyone helping the other person in the team, basically.
Okay. Yes. Coordination. Is not going to say, you know, I'm going to go right, okay, then go left. He's not going to do that. He's going to say, yeah, you know, I need to do that because that ball needs to move into that goal. It's got to hit that net. That's the thing. He's not thinking, I need to score that goal. And the moment those people start thinking that I need to score that goal, there goes your team. And that's true for anything that you want to do, anything. It's true for, you know, anything you're doing in a group. Because the team scoring the goal is what's the best thing. So Sachin Tendulkar has played his biggest innings when he's not been looking at the scoreboard. When he's not been in possession saying that, you know, Sachin, we need you to score these runs. Please go do more magic. When he's left free, he does these things. Why am I talking about sports? Does anyone see any connection? Pardon? Forget about the textbooks, forget about all the jargon. What is the connection? So think, yeah, it is teamwork. What does that mean? What does that mean? Yes?
It means that you and I are part of the team, you are just a person.
Okay.
And we work together to the country.
Okay. And someone will write a song about that. But.
Binaries.
That's a big word. So I don't know what you mean.
By binaries, I mean not creating yourself
going to say for the next talk, right? Or numbers and all that stuff? Okay, but anyway, you just said fractal as well, didn't you?
Fractures.
Fractures, okay, all right. So, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I believe that the whole link up between a team and the conservation issue is that, like how everyone needs to play their own part in team, that's exactly what we need to do in conservation, and everyone needs to be having to do whatever little they can do possibly, whether it's like going about conserving their own local patches, or it's about, you know, taking care of what's in their backyard, but everyone needs to do that little something that they can do by themselves.
Because those funds are allocated and those funds are seen as finite, right? There is competition. There is, we compete to conserve. It makes no sense whatsoever. Every single thing. I've been in places where two different snake rescuers come there and then fight as to who needs to take the snake away. I've seen organizations backstab and, you know, completely malign other organizations to be able to get a grant. I've seen ridiculous stuff happening. And everyone says, you know, with the angels singing and everything, we need to conserve. We're here for conservation. And the problem is, you know who gets it at the end of the day? You know who gets the funds, the grants, to take away the snake from ourselves? It's the ones who can convince. And how do we convince? How do we convince? We convince with media. We convince with gimmicks. What is Save the Tiger? You think it needs billions and billions of dollars that are coming? Do you think Save the Tiger is good? That's going to save the tiger? Like I said earlier today, where are you going to put the tigers? There's no place left for it. All the well-managed parks are bursting at the seams with tigers. Conflict is on the rise outside. We have too many tigers, too many elephants, too many leopards, too many bears. Why do we have too many of any of these things? Because we're not willing to give them any more space. Because we're not willing to learn how to live with them. I've been to conservationists' houses when they called me to help them with the snake problem in their house. And they want me to take the snake away. Of course, I'm not so careful about what I need to say to them. Because I shouldn't have to say it to them. But I've seen old ladies in villages sweep a cobra outside her house. That's it. But she doesn't want to kill it. She doesn't say, no, it needs to go away somewhere else. She doesn't want it in my kitchen. That's the only thing. And she probably says the same thing about her grandchildren as well. So but that's the only thing that's going to save these animals. Space. Sharing of resources. Coexistence, this big thing, you know, we need to coexist with everything, as long as it's there. We want to coexist with these massive predators and venomous snakes and all these things, as long as we can go visit them somewhere, not if they're around us. So, how are we going to do that? Is that the humane thing to do? In this entire structure that we call civilization, where is the possibility then for conservation?
that's not conservation. I would think of a much better word for that. That's preservation. When you put something in a bottle or a cage or a tank or anything, however grand or large this cage or tank is, it's just that. So when tigers only have room, or king cobras and pythons can only survive in protected areas, these national parks and tiger reserves and everything, what is that? It's just a grand zoo. It's a walled in place, so we say, okay, fine. This is where they are. If they come out of here, then that's not it. You know, the government of India actually, if you have land next to a protected area, you have to plow that land every year, otherwise you could lose your land. If the forest comes back onto your land, you could lose it. So where's the incentive then? Where's the incentive for a farmer to say, you know what, I think I'll stop farming now. I'll put up one tent, or two tents maybe with a platform, and I'll serve people tea. And I'll let the forest come by, and I will charge these people $200 a day to come and watch the tigers that I am not killing. No, that's not okay. You cannot have tigers on your land. How can you make money on tigers? Yeah, what's wrong with it? What's wrong with making money off wildlife? Because that's our currency, right? We can't barter things anymore. It would be perfectly fine if we went out and if it was still the barter system and we went out and said, you know what, it's cold now, I'm going to go get you some fur and you give me some rice. That's how, what was wrong with that? There was nothing wrong with that. So we still say, and most often, you know, when you see everything in the papers or you see, see stuff on Facebook and stuff like that, you know, it's all the hard-hitting things. It's animals, you know, rhino horns being cut off. It's terrible stuff. Baby rhinos being shot because they're just there. No horn or anything. It's terrible. And you know what? I get angry when I see those things. But then, people are using that anger to make money. It's as simple as that. Donate. You're saving the tigers. A fraction, a fractured fraction, goes to the grassroots levels where it's needed. Nothing. Billions and billions of dollars to save the tigers. What do you see? You see a watcher in Silent Valley Tiger Reserve. It's going to be a tiger reserve. What is he there with? He's still in his chappals, one lungi, one torn sweater, one umbrella that he repairs, and a torch with two cells, two batteries, that he can use a month. He's supposed to fight off poachers. But dinners and galas and everything are happening all over the world to raise billions of dollars to save the tiger. So what do? We have these massive dinners, these extravagant things, huge carbon footprints, right? Huge carbon footprints. Use more resources, put more pressures on the tiger because we're saving the tigers. And then that money doesn't even go to the place where they can save it. Administrative costs. We're not being truthful. We're not actually conserving anything. That's the problem. We're just finding a space that's convenient. And we say, you know what? Now I'm going to put this picture that I took of a tiger around the world, and suddenly you get what's called the YAG response. You know that? It's very similar to the gag response. Called You Are God. It comes in the threads under that. You are God. What a picture, Ra. You've taken a picture of a tiger from a jeep. What's the big deal? Right? How is that being a conservationist? I'm saying that. I'm not saying I do not want to take away from anyone who's actually made beautiful pictures of these animals. But that's not conservationist. You're not an environmentalist. You're not doing anything. You're just taking a picture. You're an ace, incredible, brilliant photographer, but you're not a conservationist. So here I'm going to now start tackling a few big names, okay? Anil Kumble, right? He decided I'm going to retire soon, so I'll buy myself a camera, and he went to the Masai Mara, because, you know, cricketers make a lot of money, so he went to the Masai Mara, took some pictures of tigers and the wildebeest migration and everything, came back and became Karnataka's advisor about wildlife. I mean, I'm not going to tell him how to spin ball, right? But how can he tell me, or anyone, what to do with wildlife? That's a gimmick. Let's talk about other gimmicks. Favorite Bollywood actor? what was it? But Salman Khan. Giving of Salman Khan. Are we committed to anything? Just ask ourselves that. I'm not saying that you should be committed to anything. But if you're not, don't say that you're not. We need to start calling a spade. It's as simple as that. It's okay, the world will keep turning after we're gone. No problem. Evolution will start again, 540 million years, something will happen. There will already be life, so we have a bit of a head start, and a lot of the places cool, right? In fact, it'll cool a lot more once we're gone. But we don't owe the planet anything. The planet also doesn't owe us anything. We're here, what we make of it, we're making of it for ourselves. We're doing it to ourselves. We are not the only ones with the power to save the planet. And it's humane, it makes no difference. Humane, we need to talk about that when we're actually interacting with each other. That's, yeah, that makes sense. Between us and the planet, it's actually a problem. Because when, by definition, being humane means don't kill very often. It doesn't only mean kill humanely. So often they don't, they go to the other extreme and they don't kill. Right? Where do things like those cattle go? So ecologically, cattle are a construct. We made them. Right? We took them from wild animals and we made them cattle. They're ours. But we equate them and synonymize them with wild animals. So, in Kerala, for example, in 96, it would have been, 95 or 96, when the first ban on slaughter came out, the husbandry department released all these cattle where? Perambikulam National Park, Sahaji Valley National Park, now Tiger Reserve. How can you do that? So what happens? Do you think, okay, there'll be more food for the tigers? No, they won't. There'll be anthrax, rinderpest, foot and mouth disease. I saw dozens of dead deer. I saw gaur sick and falling all over the place. There's the last thing I'd like to talk about, being an animal lover. As dubious as that sounds. How many of you are animal lovers? Yes, we love animals, right? The problem is we love the darn things to death. Someone earlier said respect, right? So what is the difference between love and respect? Any idea? What is the big difference between love and respect?
Love comes and goes.
I'm going to actually walk 6 inches off the ground when I leave this college. No. So, anyway. Yes. Yes. I mean, yeah, but what are those things? You might also respect something and not necessarily love it. So, yeah. Go on. Okay. I'm sure there's a few guys in this college who don't agree with that. But anyway, yes?
Oftentimes when we love something, we want to own it in the sense that we want to keep it to ourselves and become possessive about it.
It's a possession of attachment.
Possession of attachment. Maybe, yes?
Respect is when you think well of something or someone. Love is when you actually care about that something.
Okay. I was actually hoping for someone to give me this answer. But anyway, I think the big difference between love and respect is that love is from me to whoever, right? It's my projection of a self. Respect is what I see. That person has the power to earn respect. That thing is something that is earned and deserves respect. So love is something that just goes out of me and whole bunch of biological things that happen. So, but when we talk about respecting wildlife, we respect an animal, okay? But when, you know, I think actually a good thing would be parents love their children, right? Parents love their children. But the parents who respect their children are the ones who say, you know, my child is going to learn. My child is going to make this choice. And yes, there will be consequences, yeah. What I will be is that safety net. The ones who only love their children are the ones who basically say, you know what? No, 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 don't touch that, don't touch your head guard. Oh, you fell down, I'll beat the ground. No. There's a big difference there. There's a massive difference in these two things. Okay? If we respect this planet, we would be akin to tribals. And I think the ones that we've seen a lot of would be the American Indians. We can't call Red Indians anymore because of the humane construct of not being able to use words. They were actually just terms. Right? So now, we call them the American Indians. Right? But everyone else who came to that land after them, by the way, is called American. You don't have Irish Americans. Okay? You don't have German Americans. You don't have any of the other Americans. You have American Indians and Americans. Okay? So think about constructs. Think about how words can change. Know how you perceive anything. But we've all seen movies of with American Indians in them, right? We've seen the fable, kill the deer and then sit down and pray for his spirit. Yeah, that's a bit much, but understanding that, you know what, I need this much from this animal or from this space and take that is the only way that we can survive. It's us. Otherwise, what's going to happen? Our resources are getting slimmer and slimmer. We're getting less of everything else. Something like dal is getting, you know, so expensive. In the next 10 years, where are we heading? What's going to happen? What's going to happen? Same thing. The poor will die, the rich will die. And you know what? Some rich folks might think, yeah, that's fine. I'll be fine, right? Okay, another 10 years, dude. Then what happens? Who's going to do what you can't do? What you're unable to do, when the entire thing falls down and collapses on itself, who's going to plant food for you? Where are you going to get it from? Milk comes from cartons, but who's going to put the milk in the carton? Let's not even go to the cow, okay? Who's going to boil that milk and make sure that you're not actually going to poison yourself? It's not that easy. We have a currency, we think that as long as we have it, and as long as we can buy what we need to buy, we're fine. Have you even stopped to look at the economy? You'll see what's happening. Everything is a myth now, it's a fabrication almost. The cost of a house. Why would 20 square meters cost that much? Fabricated. Hype. For profit. So then, suddenly, you know, one apartment here is worth so much money, so one tiger is worth only this much money, so let's give the tiger this much space. Let's give apartments all this space. Who's making that? Everyone talks about ecotourism and all these other things, right? What are we doing? We're creating jobs. Can anyone define ecotourism? Anybody? You know, actually, I think I said last thing a while ago, but I say a lot of things. So, define ecotourism. I'm in a college, so I said, you find, you think I mean one statement or one sentence. Go ahead, just talk about ecotourism and tell me what it is. What is ecotourism? Has anyone been an ecotourist? No? Yes?
Ecotourism as in ecological tourism might mean going to a place that is other than your place of residence to watch ecological environment.
Okay, cool. Actually sounded like a definition. Any other ideas what ecotourism might be? That was a half hand up.
Ecotourism can be looked at in two ways. Like, one, if you go to Kashmir and you stay at a resort and you go skiing, that's tourism. But if you go to Kashmir just to like ride around Kashmir, see the wildlife, see the birds, the plants, you take in the sights, sounds and scenery, that is the natural environment and not built up or man maintained things, that can be ecotourism in a sense.
Where will you stay?
You mean not your home.
Okay, alright. Do you have something to say?
Well, going by current standards of what's going on in India, ecotourism seems just like spending off money by making people see wildlife. Or making them see their stereotypical image of wildlife.
Okay. So, yeah, today in India, or pretty much, yes. It should. Okay.
Yeah.
And when we say all the locals, so might as well do it. I've been using names, so I might as well use names more. The Taj, okay? Let's talk about the Taj. CC Africa, the Taj, all these places, they do ecotourism, right? Because they go to a place that is ecologically and environmentally sensitive, yes. So they're going to be very sensitive by building a monolithic, massive structure there. Numerous things that they fly in, all kinds of stuff for their food and for their guests who can pay for that thing. They have a massive carbon footprint, and then they request their guests not to put their towels in for wash every day. Right? There's a thing, and these Taj things, all the please be sensitive to nature. Do not wash your towels. Absolutely don't have them. Well, let's go down, okay, and let's have. Oh yes, we have the best chateaubriand in this from Belgium. Come on, that's not ecotourism. We have given jobs to 20 people from the location. It's not ecotourism. Ecotourism is when those people there, those 20 people and their families and their community all say, get together. You know what? We have not destroyed our tigers. Our tigers are still here. We have not destroyed our forests. We have not burned down everything. We have not pillaged and plundered our land. We'd like to share this with you. Come stay in our homes. Would you like to eat our food? We can assure you that we will boil our water. That's your thing. Because what does that say? That's actually turning a paradigm over on its head and it's saying, you know what? Thank you guys for leaving this first. And what you have done so far has value. And because of that value, I'm willing to give you the only thing that I can give you, which is this $150. Because I have no worth. Because the things that I have done have actually made it harder. You are saving my life. You are giving me oxygen to breathe. You are making sure that the web of life that we so easily doubt still exists. So thank you. Here I am. Thank you for your interest. That's ecotourism. But we don't do that at all. We don't do that. We decide, okay, fine, you know what? I'm going to stay at so-and-so palace. And so-and-so palace has box to look at birds every day. I have no birds. That's not the truth. That's a lie. It's a lie that we're safe behind because it's legal. That's all the other things that we're safe behind because it's legal. So, I think the decision really is ours. And I'm not saying we need to go out in the streets and boycott and picket things and all that stuff. Just make a choice. And then if we're not making a choice that actually is contributing to conservation, then we need to not say that we are. That's important. That's important for the people who do want to make the right choices, to not be blinded by misinformation, not be blinded by propaganda, not be blinded by this structure that we have. We need to feel the responsibility for 25 million people dying from starvation in the world. It's not just some fluffy little humane thing. That's a structural issue. Because those people, it's not that there's no food, it's just that they can't buy it. That's the problem. So every time we toss a burger out, we use an extra napkin, anything, the butterfly effect, my dear friends, does happen. And I know we laughed about it earlier, but we are responsible as well. All of us here are responsible for everything that's going on in the world. And might be less responsible, might be responsible within the bracket that's okay, might be responsible, you know, within the legal limits, we're not poaching any tigers. But people who we laud when we see, when we use names, when we say it's been so inspirational, when someone has actually changed an age, right, are the ones who are not okay with just what's okay. They're the ones who said, you know what, this is what I need to get. This is a desired state. My current reality is not good enough. And right now, our current reality is really, really scary. It's terrifying. And let's see, 10 years, what happens? So, if anyone has any questions, skins or attacks to make cobras come out. We can. So I still have. I don't know. It's okay. It's wasted enough time. Yes.
So what do you think can be done to help the situation? The most practical thing. What's the most practical thing that can be done in the biggest way?
I think that actually is a question that needs to be answered by individuals. How much do you want to do? Okay, so I can speak for the choices that I've made. Okay, so the choices that I've made is, I want is, one, I do not want to see conservation as a cause. Hence, I've started a business. It's a responsible business. And it's not doing very well because we spend too much money on conservation. And so that's, I keep getting chartered accountants that are very upset with me. So, two, I needed to be inclusive. This is a choice that I made. So, as opposed to going and starting a resort at this place that we've just got in Maharashtra, well, southern Maharashtra near Goa, so it's close enough to some really good food. And I said food because we're in college. What we're doing is working with the community there. And we're trying to set up this thing where the community, they've got 6,000 plus acres of community owned forest. And they can't farm it because of the conflict with wildlife. So we're saying, okay, fine. You roster out. You tell us who's going to be a driver, who's going to be a guide, who's going to have a homestay, all those kind of things. And we'll train you. And then they have it. So suddenly this thing that was a burden, this white elephant that they had, right, suddenly it'll bring value. It's not going to be sudden, rest assured. It's going to take time. But at least the way they approach it could change soon. And then you have, you know, you have 400 families there. That's actually not that big a number of people to sustain from 6,000 plus acres of forest, with the occasional tiger, with bear, with wild dog, with leopard, with otters, with pangolins, with slender lorises. Everything is gorgeous. It's beautiful. And what do they see it as? A burden. Because of our construct of currency, yes, it's a burden. Right? And because they're not allowed to do anything with these animals. So anyone who goes out and shoots a sambar and takes it home and eats, he's an outlaw. He needs to look over his shoulder. But if someone came in and said, you know what, thank you for not destroying your 6,000 plus acres of forest, I'm going to pay you this one. So what the role we're doing is we're going to make this, help them make this society, we position it, set up a website, market it for them, but it all goes to them. And in return, they're sharing their space with us. We will do our research. We work with the schools. And that's what we want to do. And it's fun. But I'm never, ever going to be able to buy myself a hummer. I'm just joking. No, I don't want a hummer. I actually want a Toyota Hilux. Which will last me 30 years. So it's, by the way, the terrorist vehicle of choice because it's just so perfect.
So I want to come back to reptiles again. This problem is about the new age trend of snakes which we have been facing. After all the series and all that stuff, like jumping on the snake oil, the famous video of you with the cobra in front of you.
Okay.
I saw it when I was like fifth or something, which is which is also leading to more and more people getting attracted to the snake, does not know how to identify it and just grab a Russell swiper as if it's a bloody rat, and then that leads to more and more snake. So most of the people are
saying things have changed. It's actually our secret plan. So we want more and more people think that they can handle snakes without going for any training or anything, and then the population will drop.
But then, there is another side of it, that the new age trend of snakes, they handle snakes with utmost disrespect. Like I've seen pictures of people with snakes, like, you do not do that, and that role that is just for the cool quotient on social network of sites, which does not help any way in conservation. How can you deal with such people?
can't tell you because it's probably illegal
what?
The way I like to deal with it.
Same here, but.
No, but okay, here's the thing, this whole thing of friends of snakes, right? This whole talk about snake lover, animal lover, friend of animals, friend of snakes, friend of planet Earth. See, when you say friend or lover, it's generally a two-way thing. Okay. It is. Okay. I will be your friend. I am your friend. Right? It's not. It's a two-way thing, and snakes don't want to be left alone. That's all they want to do. They don't want snake lovers around. So it's, see, when I started television, okay, 95-96, National Geographic was a really awesome thing. Okay? They were really great. Anything that was said on screen, they wanted a cross-reference, they wanted to make sure it was right. The person who was handling this the animal had the absolute say in whether the animal needed to stop or not, or needed a break, or any of this. That changed really rapidly. By 98 with Steve Irwin, okay? Every other channel and network was losing ratings, okay? And that's what it, and my disillusionment at that time, it was just, it took about 3 or 4 years for me to just say, you know, enough, I can't take this anymore, type of thing. But it was that bad. It really, television is that bad. So when people, you know, in an argument say, I saw it on television, I said, shut up. Because it means nothing. They lie, they cheat, they fabricate, they make up stuff, and it's not about the animal. And that's the biggest change that affected me. And that's the biggest change that affected the audience as well. When it ceased to be about the animal, it ceased to be just this commanding voice who everyone knows and everyone knows who I'm talking about, right? Who am I talking about? This is a test. Who am I talking about? Yes. That should have been one resounding single word answer from everyone, but anyway. But one commanding voice and then everything, the visuals and everything with the animal. Suddenly it became about, you know what? This is the most dangerous snake in the world and I struggled to put my shorts on this morning and all those kind of things. It was really tight shorts. I mean, everyone has to admit that. War,
great
sorry.
Mark.
Thanks to a stingray that killed him. Right? And this, I'm being really insensitive here, right? How can you die from a stingray? They're the most peaceful, gentlest things on the planet. What would he have to have been doing at that time? Pardon? I have stepped on stingrays by mistake. They don't just lash out. They don't. He would have been trying to grab it and do his ridiculous garbage. Everyone says Steve Irwin inspired me. Well, then you know what? You're taking the wrong things from for inspiration. Someone, a good snake handler, will be able to bag a cobra without it even putting its hood up. Because why does the cobra put up? Defense. He's terrified. So that's the thing. We've done lots of things, even things like rescuing and relocation. People say, you know what? We'll take it from here, we'll put it in a forest. Yeah, so I'll take you from here and I'll put you in Afghanistan. How will you survive? You don't know the places, right? You don't have the food sources, you don't have your range, you don't have your territory. They don't, and we all thought that we were doing good stuff. We know that we're not doing good stuff now. We've learned that that's actually bad for them. Now, despite telling people that, you know, these are mistakes that I made, these are mistakes that, you know, other people have made before me, people don't want to change. You want to make the same mistake? You want to kill more snakes, yes. Snakes die. 97-98% of the snakes that we relocate die. You want to do it? Yes. Why? Because it's not in your face. It's actually better that snake is bludgeoned to death right there, because at least you're not affecting another ecosystem. That other ecosystem, this pristine ecosystem, just still stays. You guys have water monitor lizards and reticulated pythons in Burundi National Park because we're not willing to say, you know what, this animal needs to die. So what do? We go put it in an ecosystem. We're still thinking humanely. We're thinking about the individual, not the system, not the larger organism, not the planet. We're thinking individually. Hence we cannot kill something. Hence it'd be so sad if this cute little bunny had to die. But this cute little bunny has mixing metosis and it's spreading it like wildfire. It's overgrazing most of the growers and all that stuff in Australia. not, our sensitives don't work. The new age snake rescuer is unfortunately very new age. I'm hoping that it will settle into something that is more constructive. We're working on mandates and policy, and hopefully the government will actually mandate it. We know in 6 months or so. Because our government works at lightning speed. So we keep going, taking snakes away from them. Then the little place that used to have 30, 40 snakes in it, they were maintaining a balance and being a control on the other prey species. They're not there anymore. Those prey species boomed, right? And since architecturally we haven't figured out how to put glass domes over houses yet, snakes from other places will come in and say, hey, really great real estate. So let's do what the humans do. Let's move in here. Right? Lots of food. Let's eat. Snakes and all these animals, when they're moving, is when conflict is greatest. The best thing to do is let it be. So I've lived 30, long time, on my farm. And I told you earlier that I could find snakes at will. I've always had at least 4 or 5 dogs. Okay? We've not had a single incident, except me getting bitten with that because I was holding a cobra by its head. I would bite someone who's holding me by my head. But not a single incident. Not a dog that's died. Yeah, we use duck eggs sometimes, we use chicken eggs sometimes, or the chicken that tried to protect the eggs. But that's okay, I prefer the snakes. So, and all we need to do is really, I mean, if you put in like a 1/4-inch mesh thing, then no snake that can kill it up or eat an egg is going to come in. But it's nice that the snakes get some eggs. So it's so easy to live with them. There's a place near, do you know where Burdwan is in West Bengal?
Yeah.
Just west of Calcutta. And just outside there, there's a place called Panswala. So it's actually 5 places because it's not for me. 5 places. Panswala means 5 villages or something like that. But they worship the goddess Jhambai Devi. And they believe that she manifests herself in the form of the monastic cobra. So I visited there. This was 2001 or 2002 or something. And in 2 hours, I saw 5 or 6 cobras pissed around. I saw people walking past them. The coolest one was a cobra on this haystack, right? And these kids playing some stone game right below it. And I thought, wow, this is, you know, the words of Brian Adams who died and got to heaven before that. But also not great music, but anyway. So I spoke to the village elders, and in all their memory, and this guy was an elder, he was really old, 2 people had been bitten. Neither of them died, neither of them had gotten anti-venom. So the snakes had bitten them, but not injected venom. This little girl, and she had been bitten just like a year or 2 before I had gotten there. No effect on her, nothing whatsoever. Okay. Another guy was a guy who stepped on a snake and got bitten, and the only thing that happened was a little bit of gnarling at the edge of where the bite was on his toe. So these snakes are not looking at humans as threats. I couldn't get one to put up also, because they didn't see us as threats. Even though I was holding it by the tail, take a photograph. That's possible. And we know about coexistence, that's coexistence. People, the uneducated people who we must educate and all that stuff, they're the ones who are doing it right. The savages, the barbarians, the tribals who don't have any sensitivities, more educated, uneducated. It's possible. Yes. You've written them up.
So this one is by Rishi. Do you believe the George Carlin theory that saving the planet is but a pretentious means to our ambitious ends? These animals are getting extinct far faster than they have been doing since centuries. What's happening? Can't surely be a natural phenomenon, right?
Who's Rishi?
He's not here.
Oh, okay. I actually answered that question earlier today. I said yes, it is a pompous thing. We're not saving the planet.
Next is by Ishika. Even though every point you have made is an unfortunate truth, it's a very defeatist way of looking at things. How do we put our prejudices against humanity aside and deal with conservation using the space and resources we have now?
Okay. Ishika? Yeah, okay. It's not defeatist. And what I'm saying is that a spade needs to be called a spade because that's the only way we can use it to keep. Right? If I'm saying that we are allowing ourselves to have our hands tied. And as long as we feed the system, as long as we're a part of that system that does that, right, that says, this is what's right, this is what's cool, and hence you should wear it or buy it or anything. This is what's, this is legal, even though it's damaging someone else. 25 million people dying a year from not having the food that you threw out. It's fine, it's legal, you haven't done anything wrong. See, those are the things that are wrong. Okay, it's what we need to do. And the reason I'm saying it's not that it is, what I'm trying to do is to convince everyone here, and in doing so also bolster my conviction, that the one way we can actually do this thing is to say, this is what's wrong, and this is what we're going to do about it. The problem is no one's actually saying what's wrong. They're saying, this is what we're going to do about it, but not addressing the right question. Far from the fears. I still believe we have time enough to change and do things. Don't have much, but yeah, it's still there.
What are your views on trophy hunting for the sake of raising money for conservation?
You didn't ask the same question. Trophy hunting, I used to actually think that it was a viable way, but I think it's despicable. I think that, trophy hunting, aphrodisiacs, all these things, they fall into the same thing. Chinese food is, it's one of the biggest conservation issues on the planet. Chinese. But it goes straight back to what we talked about. How many of us have got something Chinese here? Yeah? Everything is not made in China. It's cheapest. What comes from China is cheapest and it's the easiest that's available. But we all will do that. We're making that, it's that same system. So when people say, trophy hunting, what it's making, right? So I just think, South Africa, okay, fine. So they've got so many black and so many white rhinos, and there's this problem, and they're generating millions of dollars to save those rhinos. I should think, that's fantastic. So every single rhino was watched over 24 hours a day. I thought, brilliant. But the problem with facing the system, with the system, is that you will lose. What we need to do is actually say, that system, that construct, is the one that's gotten us to this place. So we don't need to tweak it, we don't need to change it. We need to break it down and rebuild another system. And that's the difficulty. Because it means it's going to be really inconvenient and uncomfortable for us for a while. It really is. And then things will get better. But not a single generation in the history has decided to be that generation. Not a single one. And we need to do that, and that's the problem. It's getting louder, voices are getting stronger, but I just read this thing the other day that the Senate, the US Senate is going to decide whether the science behind global warming is something that they agree with or not. How is that? They're going to agree whether the science is right or wrong. These two jizz out there are going to agree on science. So, they actually be in that state.
What role should media play in conservation?
Okay, so the media. Arnav Goswami will shout. The media is basically. We are power, we fuel the media. The media does what the media thinks we want to have. And from my time in television, I learned that that's basically it. The networks decide that, this is the audience that we are going to go with, and this is where we can sell most airtime and how we can do it. And there is little, if any, scruples to what they say. Discovery lies all the time. They fabricate scientists' opinion. All kinds of terrible things we watch. So, I think we need to spend less time watching TV. I think we need to spend less time, just reading the news. I think we need to spend less time on the internet. I think we actually need to go out, as fluffy and daffodil-esque the sounds, I think we need to start going out and growing something. I think we need to, head out for a walk somewhere. not go to an IPL match. The media is what's holding the IPL match. You know how much resources an IPL match is. When every one of us has a television or a laptop or an iPad or a phone that we can watch it on, we have this massive footprint. So it could just be those, you know, 24 guys there playing and being videoed and worded. But you know what we need to do? We need to get all those big finger things and whatever you call the boozellas and all that kind of stuff. And then throw them away at the end of it. It's thrown. It's destroyed. It's wasted. We're the educated ones, so we're allowed to waste. So it's these things, and that's media. I don't trust the media with the role that they
do. So you believe nothing positive can come out of it?
Out of the media?
Yeah, in any way.
Okay, so if we look at media over the ages, okay, there's been religion, there's been commerce, there's been propaganda, there's been politics. Okay, it's all media of some level or the other. But there's a message that's going out to a vast number of people. Invariably, it says that these vast number of people need to conform to a certain construct. I keep using this word because it's something that we need. We need to conform to it. It's not saying, you know what, you know best for what's good for you, but then you go out and face the consequences for it as well. Okay? No one's saying that. They're saying, this is right, that is wrong. This is good, that is bad. This is the best way to invest. This is what the kind. These are the kind of clothes you wear. All these kind of things. The media, the only reason we need media is if we want to be told and we're not willing to actually get our hands dirty and learn. So the media is good for, media was really good for Adolf Hitler. Media is very good for Martin Luther King assassination of the cover. Media has been really good in India as you've seen. The things that we're actually doing. Gives the media too much power. If the media was just entertainment, yeah, okay, fine, that's just media. But media doesn't have a role to play. They should report it. They shouldn't be affecting these things, they should be reporting it, they should be doing those things, because it needs to come from us. We need to stop looking for leadership, we need to stop looking for, you know, guidance, we need to stop looking for someone else to be our buffer, our safety. We can go with these things and whatever they say, because that's what everyone is going with it, and then. So since we're in this big flock of wildebeest, chances that, you know, one line is going to get us very low. But if we stand out on a rock somewhere, then that's a bit dangerous because it's very dangerous. So we go with the flock. But it's not the nicest thing to hear about ourselves. So that's what we do. Yes?
That follow-up question. When you talk about selling the rights to trophy hunting, when the animals are either really old and going to die out, or it'd be better if the animals aren't pregnant at that place, the amount of money that comes out of it, it's being used for the very same conservation. So how is that bad? Especially, I mean, also there have been studies done on these trophy hunters that they were, most of them said that they would even go for a poorer. And a poor trophy for the same amount of money. So how is that bad?
Because such is actually not bad, it's just dysfunctional. Okay, because it's a system. Why do we need, think about it at its core. Okay, it's very core. So trophy hunting is a band-aid. Okay? It's a band-aid that's been put on a sore that's actually just festering inside. And so you say, yeah, we need money because we need to fight off the thing. It's similar to how we deal with what we branded as militia and Naxalites and all these people, right? So why did they form? Why did they actually start? Okay, I'm not saying that any of the stuff that they do is good, it's terrible, right? Look at terrorism, and it's a good place to start. Okay, where did they come from initially? They came from being oppressed, they came from being wrong. How they chose to deal with it was a stupid way to deal with it. It shows cowardice, it shows a lack of spine, it shows all these things. But that's where it came from. So how do we deal with them now? More force. So what happens? More retaliation. The same thing, if you look at this whole thing with trophy hunting, it's a mindset. I've got money in hands, I can kill. Okay? I would like to kill this thing for sport. Most of it is actually wasted. They take the horn as the trophy, or the you know, the antlers and all those trophies, but or claws and teeth and skull. But most of it is actually wasted. No one eats the lions that are bred to be killed. So if you think about it, yes, you know, we are making money, and yes, we can protect these things, but what would be greater? Wouldn't it be greater if these lions weren't restricted to these game ranches and were actually just part of something and they were walking outside at my door? And I was perfectly normal. Wouldn't it be awesome if we could actually live in a place where there's wildlife and nature all around us and we got what we needed from that? It kind of sounds fluffy and almost impossible. But wouldn't that be a better space? Wouldn't the space where we were not allergic to everything that we, you know, almost everything that we could possibly eat and enjoy? That's what's happening to our children. Why is that happening? Because of this rift. The moment someone sneezes, we'll say, okay, fine, bring out the EpiPens, steroids, and all that stuff, and hence what happens to the immunity grows. Trophy hunting takes us further from nature than we can possibly be, because no animal, even the wolverine that has this reputation for just killing, for the want of killing, none of them actually kill for no reason. I'm saying kill an animal, I'm not saying don't kill an animal, I'm saying use it. Wastage is what's our biggest problem. We waste. The wasteful packaging that we have, the waste that we have in food, the you know, wasting resources, energy, all these kind of things, those are the problems. And this is wasteful. It is wasteful on every, it's wasteful of, to kill for fun, okay? You tell me. You're the one who said humane. Yeah. You tell me, how is that okay? Because then even what we have left of the humanity is rotting away at its core fabric, and we're just killing for fun. I'm actually really good, but I'll only do it if I need to. And I learned this from tribals that I spent time with, and they're really good at doing it. But they don't, you know, just, they're not just, it's not how they pass their time. It's what they do to put food in them. And that is less impactful even on those wild animals than how we get our food. It's just not in your face. We're not in there, whatever. The organizers shuffling. Yes.
You talk about economic policies and that you're working in strong with the government, people are going to be able to do that. So what you have right now is a huge call for industrialization or even greater discrimination. More like what
industrialization.
I won't call that. This is development altogether in the government or in the policies, you know, in India, whatever. So there's a certain kind of policy structure that the government itself is following. It's about breaking down the system and reworking it accordingly. So how do you, as someone who's following policies, giving suggestions to the government, come with policies that the government itself will agree with and will actually also restructure the
I don't know if they'll agree with it.
Yeah. But so what
saying,
policies are what
you're looking
are you
at the
working
dichotomy
on?
Of what I'm saying and what I'm doing, right?
Okay. What are you doing? What are you as a representative doing which will help, which will be
I'm not going to change the government today, tomorrow, or possibly ever, right? But there is a need now to mandate how snakes or rescuers deal with snakes. Because it is terrible, it is abysmal, the kind of stuff that they do. So what we've done is we've created a policy note and we're submitting it to the government. And we're saying, you know, if you agree with this, which we hope you do, and this needs to be mandated, and then goes to the Ministry of Environment and Forest. They'll mandate it, and then goes to the Forestry Service, and then that gets filtered down into all their ranges. So basically, anyone who handles a snake, right, needs to get permission from the Forest Department. So the Forest Department doesn't know anything about snakes. So we train Forest Department folks also. But if this was mandated, it would just make the effect much more. Industrialization and politics.
About the policy.
Yes.
You said we need space for the wildlife, right? And that's one of the main things that we need right now to save it. How do you think we can create space for wildlife?
So when I was in school, there were, this was a classroom. I've actually seen monitor lizards walk along the windowsills, and all used to be absolutely fine, no one cares. I've seen monkeys outside, I've seen birds nesting inside the ducts and all that stuff. Most often not the most exciting of birds, but every now and then you get something interesting. Well, that was okay. Today we can't have that. Why? Because not going to fit anywhere here. So things were different. The way we built was different. Everyone says, where are the sparrows gone? Where's the sparrow going to make its nest? They relied on those gaps between tiles or asbestos and concrete and those kind of things where they made their nest. Everyone says the food's gone. No, the food's not gone. It's food lying everywhere. The sparrows in the Bangalore airport, right, inside the airport, because there's food there and they can actually fit in the slats. So now it's such a problem because, oh my God, now there's sparrows in the airport. But that's not nice because sparrows poop, right? But it's a big deal. So do we.
I'm sorry, we can't take any more questions. I would now request Sanchi to come up and say the vote of thanks.
Did you actually vote it?
Thank you so much, Mr. Martin, for this interactive session on reptile conservation. It seems counterintuitive how popular could be bad for reptiles, but after this talk, I've actually realized how problematic media awareness is for them. Also, it boggled my mind to hear about the idea of territorial constructs, basically the idea of constructs. I hope we implement at least half of what you spoke about today. I'd like to thank Mr. Martin again for taking time out of his busy schedule to address us. We're also grateful to the teaching staff and for their support, as well as the MMR staff for their cooperation. I'd also like to thank the audience for taking part in this session. And now I'd like to call upon Ankita to give a token of appreciation to sir.